द करंट अफेयर्स ओके फॉर द 30 दिसंबर 2020. एंड एज आई टोल्ड यू दैट यू शुड रेफर द हिंदू न्यूज़पेपर ऑलराइट. यू शुड ऑल्सो रेफर इंडियन एक्सप्रेस. यू शुड ऑल्सो रेफर इंडियन एक्सप्रेस ऑलराइट. सो दीज टू न्यूज़पेपर्स आर वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. दीज टू न्यूज़पेपर्स आर वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. So you should refer these two newspapers for your daily current affairs analysis. All right. And apart from these two newspapers, you can also refer the monthly current affairs magazine, which are published by various coaching institutes, which are also helpful for your UPSC civil services examination. All right. So today we are going to cover the important news related to the current affairs. Okay, for the 30th December 2020. All right, so let's begin with the news. Okay, so first news which is flashing is related to the digital ocean. Okay, so first of all, what is this digital ocean? So you must understand it is a digital platform. The digital means it is not the real ocean. It is basically a digital platform, right? For the oceanic data. So this digital platform which provide the oceanographic data have been inaugurated by the Union Minister of Earth Sciences, who is also the Harshvardhan. Okay, so Dr. Harshvardhan basically inaugurated the digital ocean, which is nothing but the digital platform for ocean data management. It is nothing but a web-based application, right, which is developed by INCOIS, which comes under the Ministry of Earth Sciences. All right. So it is nothing but the first of its kind, the digital platform for oceanic data management. Now, it also includes the set of applications, right, which is developed to organize, right, and present the heterogeneous oceanographic data. Because you must understand, till now the data has different sources, right? Now this data, right, will be integrated, and this data can be used for various applications. And this data have been, you know, developed by adopting a rapid advancement in the geospatial technology. So this technology was basically used to organize and present the heterogeneous oceanographic data, right, which is basically lying in the scattered format. So it will be basically a one-stop solution, or the one-stop web-based application, or the digital platform where you can easily get it, the oceanographic data, right, by this geospatial technology. Okay, now what it will benefit, right? So it will basically facilitate the web-based environment, which is nothing but the interactive environment. So it is the online interactive web-based environment for the data integration, where the different type of data will be integrated, right, and will be ultimately, there will be an option for the 3D, three-dimensional, four-dimensional data visualization on the web-based platform. It will also help in the data analysis, right, for the accessing of evolution of different type of oceanographic features. For example, you have the oceanographic features, like you have, for example, the rolling plains, mounds, isn't it? So different type of oceanographic features you will have. Okay, so for that you will have the data analysis also. Then it will also have the option of data fusion, multi-format download of different type of data from multiple sources. All these things, or all these, you know, important things basically enable the integration of the data from the various sources. All right. And it will also helpful to sharing the knowledge, because once you integrate this, you know, different type of data on the single platform, obviously it will help to share the knowledge about the ocean, okay, with wide range of users, right? So ultimately you would basically use that information, or that knowledge, that to be diffused, or that to be shared to the wide range of users. That users would be research institutions who are working for the, you know, the oceanographic research in the development. That operational agencies, strategic users, for example, you may have the Navy, You may have, you know, the maritime police. So all such strategic users may also use that data for the strategic region. Academic community, okay, those students and the colleges who were basically, you know, studying in the college or in the academics, they can also use this data for, you know, for the academic purpose also. Maritime industry also, for example, if the designing industry, if the ship designing industry or any sort of industry which is lying in the maritime zone, they can also use this data for the better inputs. And the policy makers, ultimately policy makers are the officials which belongs to the government. Okay, so these policy makers can also use this data, right? Because without data, you cannot make a vibrant and most realistic policy. So you need basically some sort of a data. That data may be utilized for the better integration of this, the oceanographic technology. Now, this digital ocean, which is nothing but a web-based application, or it is a platform, online platform, which provides this, you know, different type of information, right, as a free access, right, to the general public as well as to the common man. So it has a lot of applications, right, like you can see here. It is applications like 3D and 4D data visualizations. It has applications like data analysis. Okay, it has applications like data fusion, multi-format download, and who can use this data? The data can be used by the general public, common man, as well as this data can be used by research institutions, academic institutions, okay, operational agencies, the strategic communities, maritime industries, policymakers who can use this data, right, for the better planning in the maritime area or for oceanographic, in the oceanographic relevant field. All right. So this is basically nothing but the news which is flashing related to the digital ocean. So what is the digital ocean? The digital ocean is online web-based platform. Okay. So it is an online digital platform which will integrate the different type of information from the oceanographic region. This information can be utilized by the different stakeholders which can use this information for the various purposes. All right, we have seen everything in this news. All right, let's move to the second news. The second news is related to the ruthenium 106. So ruthenium 106, first of all, you must understand, it is a cancer therapy. It is a cancer therapy which have been developed by the BARC, that is Bhabha Atomic Research Center. Okay, it is a premier, center for the atomic research, which is located in the Mumbai, which has developed this eye cancer therapy. Okay, and this eye cancer therapy is in the form of first indigenous ruthenium 106 plaque. So this 106 plaque, which will be ultimately used for the eye cancer or the ocular tumors. All right. So what are these ocular tumors? In these ocular tumors, you will have the tumors inside the eye. So within the eye, you will have the tumors. And what are the tumors? Tumors are nothing but the collection of the cells. Okay, they are the collection of the cells that will ultimately grow or keep on growing uncontrolled way. Okay, and these cells basically multiply abnormally and they form a lump of masses. And this lump of masses is nothing but the tumors, which can happen at anywhere in the body. But when what we are talking about the ocular tumors means these tumors occur within the eye. Okay, now when we talk about this ruthenium 106 plaque, which is an indigenous treatment for the eye cancer, right? So handling of such plaque is very, very convenient for the surgeons who are basically performing such therapy. And the handling of this ruthenium 106 plaque, it is basically acknowledged to be at par with the international standard. So this is also one of the important aspect of having the ruthenium 106 plaque, which is the first indigenous treatment for the ocular tumors. And these plaques are basically made in India, okay, through the Department of Atomic Energy, which have been using, right, these plaques for the 7 cases of ocular cancer also. All right. So this is basically the news which is flashing regarding the indigenous plague, which is nothing but the ruthenium 106, which will be used for the treatment of the ocular tumors. All right. And this ocular tumor, this ruthenium 106 plague have been developed by the Bhabha Atomic Research Center. All right. Let's understand next news, that is Proxima Centauri. Okay. So what is this Proxima Centauri? So Proxima Centauri is, you know, is first of all, you must understand, is, you know, considered as the closest star to our sun. Is considered as the closest star to our sun. So what is a star? As I told you in NCERT geography, the closest star means the star has its own energy and own light. Okay. And the star is also have its planets. Okay, so star will have its own energy, star will have its own light, and star will also have its own planets. The planets revolve around the star. Okay, so the closest star, right, to our sun, we have, the scientist community have found the closest star to our sun, and it is believed that such star will have the planets, okay, which ultimately revolve around this star, which is called the Proxima Centauri. And this would give some sort of a possibility that these planets may have certain possibility of sustaining the human life also, just like a humans. So these planets will have the possibility of human life. So what is the news which is flashing in the today's newspaper is the astronomers through the LISTEN project, which is nothing but the 100 million breakthrough LISTEN project. This project was started by Stephen Hawking. Okay, the Stephen Hawking, who was basically the legendary physicist, have recently picked up a radio wave emissions, which is basically coming out from the direction of the Proxima Centauri. So by picking up this radio emissions, we can use these emissions for ascertaining the possibility of having the life in one of these planets. All right. Now, this news has sparked the renewed interest in the Proxima Centauri, which is nothing but the closest star to our sun, right? And the possibility of having the habitat of the human survival in this in the star also. Now, this Proxima Centauri, which is the closest star, it is 4.2 light years away from the sun. Okay, the light years is basically, we calculate the distance in the cosmic terms. Okay, so it is 4.2 light years away from the sun. Okay, and when you compare the mass, its mass is around 1/8 of the mass of sun. So it is much lighter than sun, but it is 1/8 of the mass of the sun. And it can be visible by the naked eye, but it is too dim to be seen with the naked eye from the sun. So you need basically some sort of the assistance from the telescope to watch or to view this Proxima Centauri. Okay, so this is the news which is flashing. So you can see here, the sun is here, the Oort cloud, the 2 light years, 4 light years, and 6 light years. As I told you that it is 4.2 light years away from the sun. So that means it will be lying somewhere here. So this is basically Proxima Centauri. Okay, so it will be lying around beyond this 4 light years circle. These are the circles are nothing but the cosmic distance from the sun. So it is lying at that place. And you will have also Alpha Centauri A, Alpha Centauri B. Okay, these are further distance from the sun, or these are a location at further distance from the sun. All right, so let's move to the new news. Next news is Zari Zardozi. What is this Zardozi? First of all, you must understand, the Zardozi is nothing but a craft which is most famous in the Madhya Pradesh. So Zari Zardozi is nothing but a craft. So now what is the news? The Madhya Pradesh government is organizing the Rang Bhopali exhibition. Okay, in this Rang Bhopali exhibition, all right, the Madhya Pradesh government is promoting a special craft. The special craft is known as the Zari Zardozi craft. Okay, this craft would basically having the special features. Okay, now let's understand this Zari Zardozi craft, which is famous in the state of Madhya Pradesh, precisely in the district of Bhopal. So let's understand what is that. So it is nothing but embroidery which is done with the metallic thread jo jo dhage hote hain, jo metallic luster or metallic look dete hain. These embroideries are basically made up of the metallic threads, and these are called kalavattu. And these forms are called zari. Now the main zari production centers, okay, because the embroidery which is made up of these metal threads and these forms are called zari, the zari productions are mainly located at the Bhopal in the Madhya Pradesh. That means the Bhopal is the main zari production center in India. Now let's understand the process of formation of zari zardozi. All right, so first of all, you must understand, as I told you, that these embroideries are made up of the metallic threads. So for making an embroidery, you need the metallic threads, right? So how would you make the metallic threads? So first of all, the whole process lies here is that, first of all, you need a metal ingots, okay? These metal ingots are melted with the help of, you know, with the help of the fire. Then the metallic ingots are melted into the metallic bars, okay? And these bars are nothing but, or the melted positions of these bars are nothing but the pasa, or which is called pasa. Now these pasas, you know, further these pasas are strengthened in the lens, right, by beating it. Jaise aapne dekha hoga na, jab lal loha ho jata hai usko, then the, you know, the people used to beat so that it can lengthen further. So in the similar fashion, the metal ingots were there, who would you put on the fire, and it will be converted into the metal bars. Ultimately these are called pasa. These pasas are further beaten, right, and it will be lengthened in this process. And then these pasas which are beaten and which are lengthened, they are further pulled through a perforated steel plates, okay? So they were further pulled through. Now by pulling through, they make it, or they converted into the wires, or they are converted into the metallic wires. And these are followed by the tarkashi process to make in, to make them further thin, right, with, you know, with the different dyes we use, like rubber dyes or the diamond dyes. So further they have been thinned in order to use them into the embroidery process, okay? The last stage of this formation is called badla, where the wires which are made up of these metals are flattened, and they are also twisted with the silk and the cotton thread to become a kasab or the kalabattu. So kalabattu and kasab are nothing but the metallic wires which are flattened and the twisted with the silk or the cotton, right? And these twisted wires or twisted, you know, wire is called, you know, your kasab or kalabattu. So this is the process. I hope it is clear. So what is the process? First, you take the metal ingots, then you convert into the metal bars, which are called the pasa, and which the lengths of the pasas are further, you know, the strengthened, right, by beating it further. And then they are pulled through, you know, some of the perforated steel plates to make them a wires. And they are followed by, you know, some of the tarkashi process to make them further thin, okay, with the help of rubber and diamond dyes. And the last stage, which is called badla, where the wire is basically flattened. They are twisted with some of the steels and the cotton thread to become, you know, a kalabattu. So kalabattus are nothing but the metallic wires which are flattened and twisted with the silk and the cotton thread. All right, so these are, you know, the process of making the zari zardari. Okay, so this is a depiction, or this is a picture of, you know, one of the, you know, the person who basically expert in this craft is making this zari zardari embroidery with the help of the metallic wire, with the help of this metallic wire. All right, then next is, National Summit on Good Replicable Practices and Innovations in the Public Healthcare Systems in India. Okay, so let's understand this National Summit on the Good Replicable Practices Innovations in Public Health Systems in India. So it is first of all a national summit. Okay, so it is a summit which was organized by the Union Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. Okay, so the organizing ministry was the Union Ministry of the Health and Family Welfare, which basically inaugurated the digital conference. Okay, which is the 7th national summit on the goods replicable practices through a video conference. Okay, so here the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare hold this national summit on goods and replicable practices in the public healthcare systems in India. Okay, this is the 7th such national summit on the goods and the replicable practices. Now, regarding this, the national summit, the first such summit was held in the year of 2013 at Srinagar in Jammu and Kashmir. Right. So ultimate purpose is to show cause, to recognize and to documentize various practices and the innovations in the public healthcare system. Okay, so that it can be used or it can be replicable or it can be used for the public healthcare systems throughout the country. And you know, the last was and the last such summit was held in Gandhinagar, Gujarat. And it was recently held through the video conference by the Union Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. All right. So this is the National Summit on Goods Replicable Practices and Innovations in the Public Healthcare Systems in India. All right. Let's understand the new Bhaupur, new Khurja section of Eastern Dedicated Freight Corridor. So what is that Eastern Dedicated Freight Corridor? So first of all, you must understand the Eastern Dedicated Freight Corridor, right, would enable the Indian Railways to run faster trains because it is totally dedicated freight corridor. Freight corridor means only the goods will be transported through this dedicated freight corridor, and it will be utilized by the railways, right, for speeder transportation of these goods. So recently, what is the news? The Prime Minister Narendra Modi dedicated to the nation the corridor, which is a part of the Eastern Dedicated Freight Corridor, which basically connect the new Bhaupur to new Khurja section of Eastern Dedicated Freight Corridor. And most of these sections lies in Uttar Pradesh. Okay, so it is basically lies mostly in the Uttar Pradesh. So it is nothing but 351 kilometer stretch of the Eastern Dedicated Freight Corridor, which connect the new Bhaupur and new Khurja section. And this section was built at the cost of 5,750 crores. And most of this section passes through the state of Uttar Pradesh. Okay, the main benefit of inauguration of dedication of this corridor is it will ultimately decongest the existing Kanpur-Delhi main line. Okay, because you must understand, when you have the single set of the lines which are used for the transportation of the public, which are used for the transportation of the freight, obviously the average distance, average speed of the freight trains would be slower because you have to give the preferences to the public transport. But now once you open this dedicated line for the freight movement, ultimately it will enable the Indian Railways to run faster freight trains. All right, because you will have the dedicated line for that. Okay, now the agro products which are basically grown in the Uttar Pradesh, these agro products ultimately can reach out to the faster speed to other parts of the country through this section of Eastern Dedicated Freight Corridor, and it will ultimately increases the export capacity of the state, because the state of Uttar Pradesh, which is completely landlocked and which does not have any port or any such, you know, the outside connection, other outside connection except through the railways or through, you know, the roads. All right. So these dedicated freight corridor will enable the state of Uttar Pradesh to send its agro products to reach to the, you know, to the furthest, you know, part of the country, and it will ultimately increase the export capacity of the state of Uttar Pradesh. Okay, so let's understand few of the benefit which will be accrued by the state of Uttar Pradesh by inauguration or by dedication this part of eastern freight, you know, the corridor or eastern dedicated freight corridor. So first of all, the three most important districts of the Uttar Pradesh which falls on this eastern freight, you know, eastern dedicated freight corridor. Okay, the first is basically the Firozabad district. The Firozabad district is basically famous for the glassware industry. Okay, so here the glassware industries would be economically advanced through the connections, because ultimately the products which are made up of the glassware, which can be easily transported, which can be easily exported. Okay, then Aligarh district also fall. The Aligarh district is basically famous for the lock industries or the hardware industries. Okay, so Aligarh district also would get benefited out of this, the eastern dedicated freight corridor. And the third is basically Itawa district. The Itawa district is basically famous for the textile production and the block printing. So these, you know, these three principal districts, which are Firozabad, Aligarh, and the Itawa districts, both three districts will get benefited out of this eastern dedicated freight corridor, which is recently been, you know, dedicated to the nation by the Prime Minister Narendra Modi. And most of this section which connect the Bhaupur and the New Khurja section of eastern dedicated freight corridor, most of these sections lies in the state of Uttar Pradesh, in the state of Uttar Pradesh. All right, so let's understand the new news. Okay, and the next news is basically coming, the preventing financing of the proliferation of the weapons of mass destructions. Okay, so this news basically, by reading this, you know, the title, you can say that preventing the finance, that means some authority try to prevent the financing of, financing of certain weapons which basically cause the mass destructions. Okay, so some regulations have been made, right, by reading this title. So what is the news which is flashing? The news which is flashing is that Turkey is the country. Okay, so Turkish parliament passed a bill. Okay, the bill will ultimately increase the monitoring, the capacity of the civil society groups. Okay, so ultimately you must understand, it will enhance the monitoring of civil society group. And it is also called the preventing of the financing of the proliferation of the weapons of mass destruction. So let's understand few background about this news. Okay, so there is a body, or there is an intergovernmental body, right, which is mandated of the task of preventing of money laundering and terror financing. The body is called intergovernmental body, which is also called the Financial Action Task Force, FATF. Okay, it is an intergovernmental body which is mandated to fight the money laundering and the terror financing, right? So the Turkey, which has basically have given the warning by this intergovernmental body, which is nothing but the Financial Action Task Force, right? So that it can make some of the changes in the domestic laws to prevent the money laundering and the terror financing. Now, the bill has so much significance in the light of the report which was prepared by the Financial Action Task Force. Now, if the Turkey do not take these steps, ultimately the Turkey would be blacklisted by this watchdog, which is also called the watchdog of terror financing, just like Pakistan. The Pakistan is also in the list of the Financial Action Task Force, which means the Pakistan and the Turkey both are in the same side. So they might be blacklisted by this Paris-based watchdog, which is also mandated to fight the money laundering and the terror financing. So this Financial Action Task Force has given the stringent, the warning to the Turkey to change the domestic laws. Otherwise, the Turkey can be blacklisted by this the terror financing watchdog, which is nothing but the financial action task force. So the Turkish parliament has passed this bill, right? So that to overcome, you know, the problems which it can face if it is blacklisted by this terror financing watchdog. So it basically consisting of 43 article, and it has almost made changes to the 7 laws of the Turkey's law of associations, and which is the main purpose of this enactment of this law by the Turkish parliament is to from being blacklisted, or to move away from the blacklisting, right, by this Paris-based watchdog. Okay, now what is the significance of this bill, or what this bill would enable the Turkish government? So ultimately, the bill enables the Turkish government the power to appoint the trustees, okay? Because you must understand, there are different type of NGOs which are working, because Turkey is a Muslim state, okay? So in the goose of these non-governmental organizations, many terrorist, organizations are basically funding, okay? So these terror-related funding and terror-related money laundering issues are very rampant in these non-governmental organizations. Now, what the Turkey want? Now, the Turkey want to appoint some of the trustees to these non-governmental organizations which are suspicious in the nature of money laundering and the terror financing. So once the Turkish government would get the right, or would get the power to appoint these trustees, it can basically, manage those affairs of the non-governmental organizations. And also, the Turkish government armed itself to suspend their activities if they found to be suspicious, or they found to be violative of these laws. And the Turkish government also has the power to seize their assets. Okay, they can seize their assets, and they can monitor their resource of the funding. So as I told you, that Turkey is a Muslim country where lot of fundings are coming from the terror modules, which basically fund those the non-governmental organizations for making those weapons which may be used for the mass destructions, which may be used for the terror related activities. Now, to stop these activities, the Financial Action Task Force, which is based in Paris, has given the stern warning to the Turkish government that the Financial Action Task Force may blacklist the Turkey if they do not comply with the recommendations given by FATF. And following this recommendation, the Turkish government has passed this law, just like on the lines of Pakistan. The FATF also gave the warning to the Pakistan also. All right. So let's begin with the new news. Okay. So let's see this figure. So it is the Turkey, which is the capital is Ankara. So in the northern side of Turkey is basically, bounded by the Black Sea. Okay. The eastern side of the Turkey is basically bounded by Georgia, Armenia, and the Iran. Okay. The southeastern portion is bounded by the Iraq. The southern portion is bounded by the Syria. Okay. And the southwest portion is bounded by the Mediterranean Sea. And you will have the neighbors also, like the Cyprus and the Greece. And the northwestern portion is bounded by the Bulgaria. All right. So this is the political map. Okay. Political map in which the boundaries, the names of the countries and capitals are shown. So this is the political map. You can look into the map of, the Turkey. All right. Then let's understand the new news, which is Nowshera ka Sher. What is this Nowshera? So first of all, Nowshera is a place. Is a place, or it is a basically, a place which is located in the Jammu and Kashmir. So what was the problem is that the Nowshera was the place which was attacked by the Pakistani militias in 1948 on the Nowshera and the Jhangar, right? Both are the strategic locations in the Jammu and Kashmir. So in January and February, you have some brief understanding about this, the Pakistani militias which attacked on the India. So in 1948, when these Pakistani militias attacked on the strategic sectors of the Jammu and Kashmir, the two most important strategic sectors were the Nowshera and the Jhangar, right? On that time, there was only 8 brigadiers with Indian Army, okay? The one such brigadier which was known as you know, the Muhammad Usman. The Muhammad Usman was one among these 18 brigadiers who was associated with, you know, with this Nowshera region. So he was the most senior most officer who was killed in this first Indian Pakistan war of, you know, Pakistan war for fighting for the Jammu and Kashmir. So in the memory of this, you know, his contribution, he was also called as the Loin of Nowshera. The Loin of Nowshera, it is nothing but the nickname which was given to the Brigadier Usman, Brigadier Muhammad Usman, who was killed during the operation, right, to fight with the Pakistani militias in the attacks on the Nowshera and the Jangar regions of the Jammu and the Kashmir. All right. So let's understand the news after this brief introduction. So this, the grave of this, you know, the Muhammad Usman, who was also known as the Nowshera Kashir, he was basically the brigadier in the Indian Army. The grave of the Muhammad Usman is basically, you know, is built in the campus of Jamia Millia Islamia. Jamia Millia Islamia. Okay. Now, what is happening is recently a grave has damaged. Right now, the army has, you know, pointed out that the grave is damaged. Now the army is preparing to restoring this, you know, damaged grave, which is located in the campus of Jamia Millia Islamia. Now the point is that why the Jamia Millia Islamia is not restoring this grave. Right, it was asked to the dean of Jamia Millia Islamia. It says that though the land belongs to the Jamia Millia Islamia, but the grave does not belong to the Jamia Millia Islamia. So that is why the responsibility of restoring this grave does not belong to the Jamia Millia Islamia. Right. It also says that the horticultural department is mandated for the land which is lying nearby, but not the mandating which is related to the grave. So, so the ultimate responsibility of you know, restoring this grave lies with the family of the Muhammad Usman. And the Indian Army intervened in this issue, and it is looking for restoring this grave of the Muhammad Usman, who was also known as the Nowshera Kashir, who was killed in the India-Pakistan War of 1947 and 48. So the Muhammad Usman was born in 1912. And he was died in 1948, right, in the battle between the Pakistan and India. And he was only one of the 18 such brigadiers with the Indian Army at the time of independence. And posthumously means after his death, he was awarded as Mahavir Chakra for his gallant action during this war. So he was awarded basically the Mahavir Chakra. All right. So in his memory, the grave was basically built in the campus of Jamia Millia Islamia in New Delhi. All right. And one such incidence of this, you know, India-Pakistan war is that because of this contribution of this, you know, Muhammad Usman, the India inflicted 2,000 casualty on the Pakistan. That means 2,000 Pakistani soldiers were killed on that time. And Indian soldiers just suffered 150 casualties. So you can think of only 150 Indian soldiers were killed, but on that time, 2,000 Pakistani soldiers were killed by the Indian Army. And this contribution gave to the Muhammad Usman, who was the heading of Indian Army on that time at Nowshera and the Jangir section of Jammu and Kashmir. So he was awarded posthumously the Mahavir Chakra for his gallant action during 1947 and 1948 war. Okay, so this is the picture of Muhammad Usman. All right. So let's understand the new news which is related to the Kisan Rail. So what is the Kisan Rail? So Kisan Rail train, so these are the trains basically, which basically are dedicatedly are used for the transportation of the vegetables and the fruits. For example, these Kisan Rails are used for carrying the vegetables like cauliflower, capsicum, cabbage, drumsticks, chilies, onion, etc. And it is also used for the fruits transportation also, like grapes, oranges, pomegranate, banana, and custard apple. Now, many such Kisan trails are running in our country. So the Prime Minister Narendra Modi recently flagged off 100th Kisan Rail train. That means already 99 Kisan Rail trains are running in India. 100th Kisan Rail train have been dedicated to the country, which is between the Devlali and Danapur. So which will be ultimately connecting, ultimately connecting the another two sections of the India, and which will carry over 15,450 tons of these produce of the vegetables and the fruits. Okay, now let's understand some of the few important aspects of this Kisan Rail. Kisan Rail is basically moved with lot of vegetables and the fruits. So the unloading and the loading means the filling of these trains with vegetables and fruits. Unloading means you are ultimately moving down of these vegetables and fruits. So loading and unloading both of these perishable commodity. Perishable means which can perish in the shorter span of the time. So both fruits and the vegetables are perishable commodities. So loading and unloading of these perishable commodities will be permitted at all en route stoppages. So wherever the train stops, it will be permitted to load and unload these vegetables and the fruits. And there is no minimum or maximum size of consignment. That means there is no size. Any type of consignment can be loaded in the train. And the government has also recently extended the subsidy of 50% on the transportation of fruits and the vegetables through this train. So the subsidy of 50% was also extended. All right. And it is nothing but a multi-commodity train, right? Which is very popular because it carries the small quantities of the produce which are brought by the small and the individual farmers to basically for the selling purpose. All right. Let's understand the last news for the today, that is inflation target. So first of all, you must understand the inflation target is most important issue, because if you have the inflation, the value of your money will be eroded. For example, if the same piece of the bread is purchased by 4 rupees, if you purchase the same piece of bread, let's say by 8 rupees, right? And if your salary is not increased in that proportion, let's say your salary is just 100 rupees. The same piece of bread is earned or purchased by the 4 rupees. If the next day the same piece of bread purchased by 8 rupees, and the next day it reaches to 20 rupees. So ultimately that inflation will ultimately erode the value of the money, because now 8 rupees purchased only the same piece of bread. The next day the same piece of bread is purchased by 20 rupees. So the value of the money is ultimately eroded. So that means the poor people and the salaried class would have the greatest impact of the inflation, because the inflation ultimately erodes the value of your money. Inflation ka matlab hota hai mehngai, mehngai hogi. Mehngai hum kis phase mein bolte hain? When your income remains fixed, but the price of the commodity increases. So that is called inflation. So let's understand the inflation target, which is fixed at 4%, which is appropriate for India. Okay, one paper was published in such regard, which is measuring the trend inflation in India. And this paper is released by the Reserve Bank of India. Now, let's understand the brief, background about this inflation targeting. So the 4% of the inflation target, which was set by the center in the consultation with RBI in 2016. Okay. So this 4% target was set by the government of India or by the center. Now you must understand it is not possible to exactly to achieve this 4% target. So the government of India also kept some tolerance limit also. For example, the tolerance limit or upper tolerance limit for this inflation has been fixed at 6%, and the lower limit of this inflation fixed at 2%. So that means the 6% is the upper limit and 2% is the minimum limit, which was fixed by the center with the consultation of RBI. And this inflation target, validity is going to expire on the March 31, 2021. All right, now let's understand the implications of having this inflation target. So first of all, you must understand the paper which is recently published has found the steady decline in the trend inflation to 4.1% to 4.3% since 2014. Now, the most significant study of this paper, which was published by the RBI, is of two points that you must understand. The first point is that if you put this target inflation to below the trend inflation, okay, If the target is set to below, okay, that means you are imparting a deflationary bias. Deflationary bias ka matlab hota hai, you will ultimately, you know, overkilling the relative to what the economy can intrinsically bear. So ultimately, what you are doing, basically, you are putting some of the deflationary tendencies. And if you fix the target, which is much above than the trend, which is there, then monetary policy will be too expansionary. Okay. And it may also prone to the inflationary shocks. That means it may further give some certain set of the inflations. And you must understand the maintaining of inflation target of 4% is appropriate for India. And we should not aspire for, you know, the targeting above than this, you know, the 4% target. And we should also rather not aspire of targeting below than 4% of this inflation target. And you must understand certain amount of inflation is also good for the economy also. So, right, certain amount, it is good for the economy, but too much of inflation is basically, you know, erode the value of the money, and it will ultimately impact the middle class and the lower sections of the society because their salaries are fixed. Okay. And they are basically the biggest loser during the inflation. All right. So these are the news which are published or which are recently published in the Hindu newspaper for 30 December 2020. All right. So we'll meet again tomorrow for the new news. All right. So thank you very much. Who have attended this session. Thank you.